POO Endgame is one of Hack2Box Endgame Labs, which just retired. After scanning the entry point, we can see that the NIRS server and the MSSQL server are reachable. The web server just chose a default page, so we look for more content with fhuf. Besides a couple of subdirectories, we can see a DSStore file. These files are used by macOS to store some file attributes and allow us to get a list of file names in a directory without fuzzing for them. We download the file and use Python DSStore to show the file names. There seems to be nothing too interesting here, so we continue by fuzzing one of the subdirectories we found earlier with fhuf. The DSStore file in dev reveals two subdirectories which we could not have found by fuzzing. We continue fuzzing these directories as well, find a couple of new ones, but nothing too interesting. There's a Metasploit plugin that can scan for IIS short names, which can show long file names in a shortened way without knowing the full name. We run the module and find a file in the db subdirectory that starts with poo_co, followed by some unknown characters and a txt extension. We cannot request a file like this, so we use fhuf to fuzz for the full name after grabbing our word list from before for all words starting with co. After a moment, we find the file name poo_connection.txt, which has database credentials and the first flag in it. We can now use Metasploit's MSSQL enum module to get some initial enumeration done on the database. This gives us the server version, shows the user accounts, some stored procedures, and various other things. Now, another useful Metasploit module is MSSQL link crawler, which checks whether the server is linked to others and how the relationship is configured. We can see that the module found a path from our server called POO public to another server called POO config back to our server, which results in sysadmin permissions. If you want to learn more about linked SQL servers, there's an excellent blog post by NetSPI. For now, we will use USQL to interact with the MSSQL server. After connecting, we list the local databases to check that everything is working as expected. By using OpenQuery, we can make the same request on the remote SQL server and get a different result. Now the fun part is that we can query our local server from the remote server again and this time get a different result. How is this possible? Well, every server link is configured to use an SQL account, so it is possible to change permissions when using these links. In this case, the backconnect to our local POO public server is done with sysadmin privileges. I used the link to add the local sysadmin via spadd_login and add it to the sysadmin group to make future queries a bit easier. We check the MSSQL enum output again, this time from the new user we created. Now to continue, I'll use MSSQL tools because I had some issues getting output of non-select commands from USQL. We connect, run whoami via xp command shell and can see the user we are running as. Now, it would be nice to read the web.config file of the IIS server, but unfortunately our user is not allowed to do so. What we can however do is to load an external Python script, and it turns out that these are run by a different user called poopublic01. We try to read the web.config file again, and this time it succeeds, revealing the local administrator's credentials for the box. We check netstat to find a good way to log in with these credentials and can see that WinRM is running on IPv4 and IPv6. Our initial scan, however, did not show it, so the firewall must be blocking it for IPv4. This is, however, not the case for IPv6. After getting the IPv6 address via ipconfig and adding an entry to our hosts file, we can use evil WinRM to connect over IPv6. On the administrator's desktop, we can find the third flag. There's another flag in the iisstart.html file, which you can find by grabbing for the flag prefix. Before continuing, we disable Windows Defender real-time monitoring to not run into AV problems. We are local admin now, but the last flag is on the domain controller. The only domain accounts we have somewhat control over are the two accounts we are using when running commands via the SQL server. We upload mimikatz and look for cache credentials. There are two cached MS-cache v2 credentials, which can be cracked, but it will not help much in this case because the one from POO-ADM is an old one. The other local hashes are not helping much either at this point. As a next step, we upload invoke Kerberos to the box to see whether we can get some hashes via Kerberos. We cannot run it via the local admin user because it needs a domain user, so we use xp command shell again to run the script. It turns out we can get the current password hash of POO-ADM via Kerberos. After cleaning up the output, we can crack it with hashcat and the word list from seclists. Since the password is short, it could also be found by pure brute force. My idea now was to create a credential object in PowerShell and use it to access the domain controller. Unfortunately, this does not work as the admin user does not have the permissions to do so. To get an idea about users, groups and ACLs, we will use Bloodhound. I'm uploading the sharpod ingester and run it via XP command shell. After downloading the resulting zip and loading it into Bloodhound, we can get an overview. We can see that we are not a domain admin. We have, however, generic all permissions on the domain admin object, which means that we can add our user to the domain admins. The help section of Bloodhound shows how to achieve this. We use evil WinRAM to load PowerView by providing the -s parameter and the folder where our PowerShell scripts are stored. We create another credential object and add our user to the domain admins as described by Bloodhound. By running the command again, we can see that it fails because the first one already added the user to the group. We still cannot run the command on the domain controller, this time because a login session is missing. To create one, we'll make another credential object and run the command again. This time the command succeeds and we can read the final flag, which finishes this endgame.